We thought we'd do our part to help out with the agenda today, and so we worked to combine our presentations. So thanks for having us, by the way, Lori. I'm very pleased to follow your presentation because as the industry solutions group inside Intel, we focus on helping customers evolve towards their vision of the Internet of Things, Industry 4.0, otherwise known as. So we're part of the solutions systems management group. Michael also is part of that group as well, and he's specializing in the HPC components that Intel creates and markets. But my group focuses on helping customers. So I'm going to give you the line of business perspective of what's going on out there in manufacturing globally, the level of maturity that customers in a wide variety of industries are experiencing right now in their journey towards towards Industry 4.0. So Intel is a very large organization, multinational. You're probably very familiar with some of the ingredients that we've marketed through partners and which are serving you well inside your compute environment personally and at work. But we also manufacture and produce architecture, research, and specialization for other kinds of industries other than electronics. So I'm going to share with you our journey, our own journey, Intel's journey to Industry 4.0. So is anyone in the room not familiar with that term? So when I say Industry 4.0, I mean the merger of digital and physical systems. So we have the cyber physical communication whereby devices can communicate with each other. They can communicate with people, and they can communicate with their environment, both to sense, analyze, and respond. So that's basically what I'm describing. Now, it's important to note that Intel is in the electronic semiconductor industry, which is quite advanced. We have to be, because the kind of products that we produce can't be made with humans in the room. Humans are dirty. Okay, so we can't have humans in the process. So we, for a long time, have had to digitize our manufacturing process so that we could operate without people, okay? It's also important in for the context of this story to understand that Intel utilizes a copy exact model of manufacturing, which is really hard in the manufacturing world. So when we create or design a production line to make a certain kind of a product, we set up the same kind of facility in all of our locations. But that means that on the back end, when we design systems or processes to improve those operations, it's easier for us to do that. Now, that's unusual in the world of manufacturing, right? My group, as I said, I'm not in the manufacturing factory right now. I'm leading the industry solutions group, which means we go out and work with customers. And our customers purposefully are not on that front end part of the maturity spectrum, right? Most of our customers are fast followers or in the lead laggard category of those adopting IoT. So I'll try to share that perspective with you as we go along. Now, it's also important to note that what we make is hugely complex. Right, and very expensive. As the wafer travels through a 29-day process of over 200 different separate nodes of manufacturing, it gets more and more expensive as you get towards the end of that line to have any defects or failures. So we have to monitor that process as we go through the whole production phase. So it's very complex, and we're manufacturing at the atomic layer now. So it's very precise as well. So, Michael, is there anything you wanted to add to coming from the factory? Or
so a good look at Intel is to take a look at a single wafer that we produce. So as the material goes through the product line, we have an operation called sort, and this is really our first look at the structural integrity of the wafer, how it's going to function. And it is critical through through AI, through our analytics, through analyzing big data, that we're able to detect and respond very quickly to any defects that we find as that wafer has gone through the line, because we have a lot more wafers in the line behind it, and we need to contain defects very quickly and respond. So as you can see here, some data, each wafer has over a gigabyte of data. We sort thousands of wafers a day in each factory at Intel. And as Mary highlighted, a factory and a sort factory is actually separate from our main fab, and that wafer may not have come from a local fab, it may have come from halfway across the world. So with the amount of data, with over a petabyte of data per data center for each factory, we need to be able to analyze all the information that's flowing through our systems, our network, our virtual factory, as quickly as possible. So this is really our huge challenge in manufacturing at Intel, is to be able to analyze data real time and maintain that very strict control on our factory processes.
So we needed to be able to deal with all of the typical problems that manufacturing has, right? The main two business drivers are throughput and quality for any manufacturer. But there's all sorts of other sub-concerns that feed into delivering throughput and quality. And we shared the same issues, you know, high cost of maintenance and material, the high cost of waste if there's a failure towards the end of the line, as I mentioned, but also the fact that, you know, there's an aging workforce that we have to deal with in manufacturing, which is one of the top concerns of industrial manufacturing around the world. Actually, how do I close the gap between human knowledge and the demands of very highly complex equipment and processes? And then at the same time, how do I link in supply chains? Because it's not only the quality of the raw materials and delivery of raw materials to my line, but it's also how my product travels from the end of the line to the customer site. These are all very top of mind concerns for CEOs around the world. So our journey at Intel was traveled, probably 10 years ago, but this is a journey that manufacturers are traveling now. So many of the customers that your companies, your research firms are dealing with are on the lower end of the maturity spectrum, and they're thinking about, how do I get connected? How do I connect up equipment that's 100 years old on my factory floor? How do I accommodate that brownfield, that last mile connection, to digitize the information so that I can deal and analyze with the data that's coming off of it? And then when I achieve that perfect state of you know, receiving and analyzing the data, I need to put in learning models so that I can start to assess what's normal operation under these conditions versus abnormal conditions. And we saw great examples of that during the autonomous driving demonstration earlier today. But you could take that same sort of modeling and apply it in manufacturing, you'd have the same level of complexities. There's petabytes of data coming off of this equipment. How do I analyze it in such a way that I can eventually evolve to autonomous manufacturing, where I can drive self-correction back into the manufacturing line as a result of variances in the raw material quality, or maybe it's the atmospheric conditions or whatever they're dealing with. So, First, the first business imperative is to be able to move that data and connect up equipment within a network infrastructure that may not be modern or easy to solve. You know, if you're in a factory that has a lot of electromagnetic interruptions or interference, that might be challenging for them to put in all the connections they need. But this is the very first strategy that needs to, you know, be accomplished. But the whole focus of that business imperative is to reduce risk of failures, risk of brand in terms of quality and downtime. Plus, you want to optimize the use of the asset, and you want to optimize the use of the investment in production. As I mentioned, inside Intel, when you get to the end of the production line with a wafer, it's quite expensive to lose it. due to quality issues. And it's quite common in other high complex manufacturing. Also, you want to make customers sticky wherever possible. So you see the first investment in manufacturing in the area of being able to assess how their assets are performing out in the marketplace with customers. So asset quality, customer satisfaction, the demands of the environment that those assets are operating in are all very important to help drive improvements from the engineering perspective. So all of that together requires certain components.
Let's take a look at what makes up an Intel factory. So as Mary highlighted, we've really taken the human interaction out of producing our microprocessors or our semiconductor products. Everything is fully automated. The product never touches human hands. We go through a very rigorous data collection, centralizing of the data, analyzing real time, providing machine learning, analytics, everything that needs to be done to make the right business decisions. Our factories have become so advanced that the tools can actually make adjustments for advanced process controls to upstream and downstream tools. It's evolved into a very complex environment, very high output and very high quality. So to take a look at a factory floor, we have upwards of about 2,000 process tools within a factory, 450,000 square feet of clean room space. We have over 5 miles of track, vehicle track, for automated robots to travel on the ceiling to move product from tool to tool. And what's most amazing is when you walk into a factory, I've actually seen the factories over the last 10 years go from a roughly 2 whip turns, if you work in manufacturing, up to well over 10, working on 14 whip turns. Extremely high velocity of moving products, fully automated on the robots. But if you walk into an Intel factory, you'll see very few workers. It's really all controlled by machines. It's really quite impressive. We run quite a few varied workloads within the factories. It spans, a lot of them run on the Windows platform. A lot of the workloads run on Linux. Very mixed environment because a lot of our analytical tools, statistical process tools, are provided by various vendors. And we adjust those, or we work with our software providers to tailor those applications for the Intel factories. So within our high-performing computing environment, we have a very mixed workload that is continuously running and analyzing products as they go through the line.
All right, so one of the first things we needed to do was to connect up machine parameters. Now, we're fortunate in our industry because our machines, our equipment or tools, turn over quickly. So whenever there's a new product that's designed for manufacture, the tool is designed specifically for a process, right? So this is new equipment that has IoT technology built into it. So we were able to lever that connection to assess the machine parameters, which give you feeds and information on machine condition, the health of the tool as it's in operation, whether it's in spec for calibration and things like that. At the same time, then we could measure quality of the product that was coming out. So you had two separate readings coming out that weren't necessarily correlated together. So you'd see anomalies in one, the health of the equipment, and anomalies in the product quality, but they weren't necessarily married together with the exact process that was causing that excursion. So it was necessary then to figure out a way to transition away from direct connect. And there's all kinds of issues associated with hardwired, rigid, traditional industry control systems that still today are quite pervasive in manufacturing. Most of our customers, as I had mentioned, that my group is dealing with are on the lower end of the maturity level when it comes to the journey to IoT. So they're very much dealing with these hardwired connections old equipment, it's not IoTized, and there's all kinds of issues associated with transitioning into an environment where they can really leverage technology. And one of the requirements is that they do move in that direction to more of a software-defined connection to factory floor systems, which requires the ability to stream data wirelessly, but then also gives you the flexibility to apply function-specific memory or compute at the edge wherever it's needed. It gives you a lot more flexibility with being able to adjust the operations that can drive self-correction. So it was necessary for us to make this transition, and it is also for most of the manufacturing that you see, you know, around the world right now. So there's a lot of opportunity for growth in high-performance computing in order to be able to achieve this level of growth. So once we did that, then we were able to put in interim what we call shaper database, which is basically a reference semantic model that marries together when the time sequence, time-based sequence of excursions and associated with equipment health as well. So we could start to see when anomalies were occurring and what the dependencies were in the equipment that would result in a high quality product or a lower quality product. And from there we were able to begin the basic modeling necessary in order to begin that machine learning journey. And from there we could evolve to incorporate more information besides just the machine parameters, because a piece of equipment operates in a building envelope, which operates in a certain weather environment, which is impacted by the kinds of people who are working that day. So all of those parameters affect product quality eventually, and they all needed to be networked together in order to give you that kind of insight. Once we did that, we found out that, you know, with all the data streaming off, it just became impossible, really, to collect all the kinds of data that you needed. So it was really important to be able to put in real-time analytics and push the decision-making as far out to the edge, as close to the point of data collection as is necessary. And this is really, I think, a critical point and where a lot of the industrial customers are right now. You know, a lot of them have experimented with connecting up certain kinds of assets, especially on the consumer side of the business, as I had mentioned, you know, making their own products compelling for consumers. You know, this requires a great deal of analytics, and I can't afford to transport all of that data across the cloud into my data center to properly analyze. I need to be able to push that decision making out to the edge as far as possible, and this is where a lot of the work that we're doing right now with customers is occurring. Now, inside Intel, we are a little bit ahead of these other customer that we've been dealing with, and so we've understood the issues of supply chain feedback and the other contextual impacts and have been experimenting with those for quite a while. And the basic architecture that we're using to both collect and to aggregate the data is now able to start levering different combinations of private and hybrid clouds so that we can determine where the data analytics should sit, where the data models and the deep learning should occur. Is it local? Is it at a country level or a geo region? Or is it back at the corporate? Because again, we have a copy exact model of manufacturing, which is a little bit unusual, but it gives us the capability to lever our analytics at a corporate level. And then we can have a deeper understanding of the contextual impacts of what's driving excursions on our production line. So the value of being able to do this, though, means that we're able to develop a known mathematical relationship between the sensor data and the metrology data. So we can get very specific about fault detection and classification. So once you can classify your faults, then you can start to determine which are the variations that cause those faults to happen. And we can really drive down to the effects of, you know, what's causing that. And by allowing only those outlier lots to be identified very quickly, we can predict what the quality of a certain wafer and a process is going to be and get in front of that very expensive product waste on the back end. So very high value for us to be able to do this. So as Michael mentioned, I mean, there's lots of numbers here that we could point to. I'll just point out the fact that each factory is driving more than a petabyte of data every day. So we're driving a lot of data. And so we require a lot of edge compute capability in order to reduce the amount of data that's running through this network. And you know, some of the lessons that we've learned here is that you know, raw data is pretty much useless. So within 3 seconds of data being generated on a piece of equipment, the data is not worth anything anymore. So you have to be able to respond to it very quickly. And you don't want it to be in tons of different silos. You want to be able to analyze it across the field of data so that you can understand all of what's the context of how it's performing. So Intel factories are already factories of the future, but most of the customers that my team is dealing with are still on this journey. And the future, a factory of the future, will need to have a software-defined relationship between the equipment on the factory floor and the factory systems. They've got to break that hardwired connection so that they can be self-aware, they can be self-organizing, and they can interact with humans appropriately. The tool imperatives that are required are real-time and reliable compute capability at the point where they need it, and it has to include embedded security built in at the chip level. So we need hardware components.
Yeah, so with every process technology that we come out, we're on about a 2 to 3 year cadence, but every major change in our process technology, we're seeing the amount of data that we manage on a day-to-day basis double. In addition, we're continuously updating the algorithms, machine learning, adopting new models. It really keeps pushing the envelope for having a higher and higher performing compute environment that'll satisfy our needs to allow us to process material real time. Back in July, we announced a new Purley platform, the new Xeon scalable platform, and it was timely. So we were ready for a refresh. We're seeing about a 1.65x average improvement boost over the previous technology. It was based on Broadwell. It's allowed us to be successful, meet all the performance requirements that we have within the Intel fabs, and it also provides the full security solution without the overhead, and it allows us to continue to deliver to our customers seamlessly through agile methods. And the other thing I would like to highlight is, along with the Purley launch, it's a complete platform. So in addition to the new series of processors that we're releasing, it also comes along with a 3D cross-point memory stack, 3D NAND, Optane memory solution. It's really a complete platform, or we call it the scalable system framework. It comes along with the software. We've optimized a lot of the software to run on the new Purley platform, worked a lot with our software vendors, did a lot of internal benchmarking to make sure that we were hitting the performance goals that we were seeking to achieve. And also, as part of the scalable system framework, we provide the full network capabilities across the platform.
So the challenges that we faced technically had everything to do with security and trust. You know, there's a lot of security built into to our systems, obviously. They needed to be interoperable, which is really a challenge prior to having standards. You know, today there's all kinds of standards communities that are driving standard protocols. We didn't have that back then. But it's still a challenge even today for manufacturers when they talk about integrating OT and IT. Everyone's got their own language, although this is starting to normalize, especially with the help of some of the consortiums that are out there. From the business perspective, the business still wants to know, you know, for every dollar invested, how much am I going to get back? And there's quite a large amount of return on investment that is that we've been able to extract and participate with customers on. 25% increase in productivity at Daimler just by doing a better job of predictive analytics on the manufacturing line. 30% cost reduction for maintenance when switching over to a predictive maintenance strategy. And then more than 35% of the companies that, well, 100% of the companies I'm working with are adopting Industry 4.0. And I'm really was excited to hear about the projects you were talking about, Lori, because I think that one of the big challenges that our industry has now, it not just semiconductor, but all of industry, is finding the mathematical models that can represent what healthy pump performance is, for example, or healthy motor performance when it's pulling a certain weight of material under a certain environmental conditions, right? So all of those are definitely needed right now. So. With that, I just want to point out that it's not possible if you don't have partners. It takes a village. This is hard stuff. And we're just on the very beginning of the journey. So I think we want to leave you with some resources that you can get to. And thank you for your time. And I look forward to working with some of you out there somewhere.
Thank you. Thank you.
Can you hear me? So how do you see electronics fitting in the curve here? We've heard a lot about autonomous driving, and I know that the audience thought that that was a great presentation. That's sexy. Where do you see electronics in this?
Well, electronics manufacturing is more advanced in their use of IoT because of the fact that you can't have people in the process.
Yeah,
and then if you were to look at the expense of the assets that those manufacturers are producing, there's a direct correlation between the cost and complexity of what they're making versus how mature they are in the world of IoT. So aerospace and defense, for example, is also a very mature industry. Automotive is a very mature industry. Petrochem is a very mature. And then surprisingly, you know, places like pharma and biochem are a little bit further behind, but they're under regulatory requirements. So electronics is definitely leading edge, but we've been able to blaze a path of learning that we can now take out and share with customers. And that's what my group is doing with our customers that we work with. Thanks for the question.
Yeah, I have a quick question. This is a hugely complex software-driven phenomena. And my first thought is, what are the cybersecurity implications here? And I'm not talking about someone coming in and shutting off a factory. I'm talking about someone coming in and tweaking some parameters randomly. What kind of steps are you taking? What kind of steps can be taken to really make sure that this process remains as pure as it can be?
That's a great example of where you have consortiums working together. And it's not just a software issue, it's more of a hardware issue, actually, because in order for manufacturers to trust digitizing their equipment and letting their equipment receive commands from somewhere, it has to be a trusted connection. So some of the strategies that have been tried and are being deployed now is chip level security, where, you know, once the chip is deployed in the equipment, it has a trusted network connection, a trusted server library. So if communication is attempted that doesn't match that trusted address, then it shuts down the communication. So that's a rather recent development partnership between Intel and IBM, actually. All right. Well, obviously blockchain is going to require a huge amount of security, and it's built in at the gateway level, basically. Not so much on the factory floor, but definitely in the supply chain area. Because, you know, on the factory floor, really your sensors are right there by the equipment. It's monitoring what's going on. Maybe it's managing the weld, the quality of the weld, which is a very real project that's going on at automotives right now. How long does a part have to stay in that station before I get a weld quality sufficient to the load that it's required, you know, for that particular component, right? That's a very real business case. Because if I can drive out, you know, pieces of time out of that process, then I'm increasing my production capacity overall. That doesn't necessarily require blockchain, right? But it would require compute, high speed compute power with real time analytics right at the point of connection. Yeah. Exactly. So that's where you have that chip, that embedded level trusted server relationship right at the chip level on that equipment. That's a real concern, though, right?